This is a story for anyone who's ever made a list of things to do and not done them. A story for anyone who's ever had a dream that died, or made a wish that didn't come true. In short, this is a story for everyone.
There's something about the human spirit that when you accept challenge and work on it and have deadlines and capture your potential, it's astounding what you can do.
Meet John Goddard.
Little alfalfa is a treat.
He's got a wife, 5 kids, 2 dogs, a cat, and a horse. No news there.
Sweet old horse.
Oh, and one more thing. He's flown planes, jumped from planes, climbed atop elephants, climbed atop mountains, kayaked down the Congo, and, well, the list goes on and on. Did we say list? Oh, yeah. You see, there's this thing about a list.
Well, it's been a fascinating life.
And a well-planned one. You see, one day when John was 15, a friend of his dad said he regretted never having done the things he wanted to when he was John's age.
It hit me so strong that I pulled out a yellow Lego pad and started writing the things I was going to do before dying because they were just buzzing around in my head as fantasies.
127 fantasies, to be exact. Soon there were more, then more still. Today there are nearly 400 of them on the list. Fantasies like number 40, learning to fly. That's Goddard flying a fighter jet. Fantasies like number 82, skydiving, as he did here over the California desert. And fantasies like number 25, climbing Mount Kilimanjaro in Tanzania. To Goddard, it seems the unfilmed life may not be worth living. His film has been rolling for a lifetime. Much of it has been spent on top of the world.
You've climbed many of the world's tallest mountains.
Probably a dozen.
The Matterhorn?
Matterhorn.
Mount Rainier. Mount Fuji?
Fuji.
Mount Vesuvius?
Vesuvius.
Mount Everest?
No.
He says he couldn't save enough money for an Everest climb. When Goddard isn't going up mountains, he's kayaking down rivers. Goddard spent 6 months exploring the Congo River. He also kayaked down the Nile. That was goal number one for an astonishing 9 months and wrote a book about it.
Many of the things on your list are not just adventures, they're education. I mean, here, read the works of Shakespeare, Plato. Aristotle.
Yeah, yeah. Aristotle. Yeah.
Dickens, Thoreau.
Oh, I've had a long time to do those things, John.
You didn't stop there. Poe, Rousseau, Bacon, Hemingway, Twain, Burroughs. How do you find the time to do all these things?
You plan ahead. And when you write down a goal, that's a commitment. You don't just let it lie there.
Mm-hmm.
If you have any ego strength at all, you say, I'm going to really do that. And then you save money, you prepare, you take instruction, and you do it.
Okay, here we go.
All kidding aside, John Goddard, who every year leads a large group on a nature hike, is not a man who wastes a lot of time wasting time. And when we asked him what great adventure he had yet to accomplish, the answer turned out to be dog sledding. So the man whose motto is, to dare is to do, to fear is to fail, let us join him as he put yet another accomplishment in the books.
Most people say, someday I'm going to do that, and they end up, if only I had done that. And I believe in taking control of your life and making it really important and have some substance and meaning to it. See, this is called white knuckling it, not out of fear, but out of effort.
It looked like it was hard work there at some point.
Well, you have to balance and shift your weight back and forth and keep the sled from tipping and keeping in alignment with the dogs, but it's a joy.
Still, Goddard's daring do has come at a price. Although he's happily married for the 3rd time, and he admits marriages 1 and 2 may have been a casualty of his ambition. And when he made his remarkable trip down the Congo River from source to mouth, he and his closest friend, Jack Yowell, hit some vicious rapids. Yowell's kayak flipped over, and he drowned.
But before you judge John Goddard too harshly, remember, he really has explored a number of the world's greatest rivers, climbed some of its highest mountains. There's film of it. By anyone's reckoning, he's lived a life of adventure, wonder, and accomplishment. And by reaching for his goals, John Goddard has inspired others to reach for theirs.
And let me tick off a few of the things that have enriched my life.
When he's not tempting fate, he's trying to tempt students with what he's done.
Learning to fly, skydive,
hang glide, rock climb, drive a race car, water and snow ski, surf, scuba dive, read the Bible from cover to cover, become an Eagle Scout.
And urging them to dream as big as he does.
Many of us make up lists when we're 15, and frequently we give up on them by the time we're 16. How were you able to hang on to your dreams?
Wonderful role models and setting deadlines. I'm going to do this by the end of the summer. I'm going to do this by the end of next year. I never give up on a dream. Even going to the moon has never been given up.
Did I just hear you want to go to the moon?
Of course.
Significantly, though he's checked off most of his goals, there's one left from his original list, the very last one. And it may be the most important goal of them all.
Tough question for you. Goal number 127, live to see the 21st century. It's not far away.
Not far away. I think I'm going to make it.
I understand you're fighting cancer.
Still fighting it, but I'm well ahead of the game because I'm now several years over the expectancy that originally was diagnosed. I think Annie Oakley had done it one time.
In the end, Goddard says, the moral of his list and a lifetime of goal setting is that life is a daily miracle, that we live in the best time in human history, a time when with planning, preparation, and a little discipline, the ordinary person can do extraordinary things.
Life is meant to be lived fully, deeply, optimistically, without hanging on to the baggage of the past, with no fear of the future, to live each day complete.
L is for the way you look at me. O is for the only one I see. V is very, very extraordinary. E is even more than anyone that you adore can love. Here's all that I can give to you. Love is more than just a game for two. Two in love can't make it. Take my heart and please don't break it. Love was made for me.
The summer wind came blowing in from across the sea. It lingered there to touch your hair and walk with me. All summer long we sang a song and then we strolled that golden sand. Two sweethearts and the summer wind. Like painted kites, those days and nights, they went flying by. The world was new beneath the blue umbrella sky. Then softer than a piper man, one day it called to you. I lost you.
We know them. They are so adept at telling the kind of person you are. If you there's a hint of feeling superior to them, or feeling that, oh, these poor people, how could they live this way, you know, they pick up on it, and immediately it creates a barrier that prevents you from really getting to know them. But on the Congo, after my partner drowned tragically, I went on with African paddlers, and I'd go into a village and range through the chief to have 10, 12, 14 different of his men that he knows would work with a white man. And a lot of these villages, the kids had never seen a white person. So when I'd come in, they'd go screaming to mama. Couldn't understand why I didn't have any color. And there was one particular crew that just were incredible. And you know, when I first established friendship with them, and they couldn't comprehend that I was going to take them downstream 50 miles. They'd never been more than 20 miles from their village in their lives. And then they'd say things like, who will do your food? Who will do your laundry? Who will make your, you know, and I kept doing this. And they, in essence, they said, hey, he's one of us. Oh, wow. And there was no white or black from then on.
That's cool.
We were just buddies. And that is such a memorable experience to share every day everything that's going on, running dangerous rapids, you know, and seeing their courage and control and calmness. And they were brothers. And I thought, how few Belgians, it was the Belgian Congo at the time, a few white Belgians ever really got to know the people. There was always that white superiority and the black inferiority, which I've always found disreputable and inaccurate. But anyway, I had 129 paddlers overall, and it was one of the great experiences of all my African trips.
That's awesome.
And I love seeing wildlife. You know, paddling quietly with no outboard to fill the air with fumes and gliding along quietly, you'd come upon
drinking animals, and sometimes they look up at you and then think, well, there's no danger there, and they go right back to drinking. And feeling integrated with nature that way, well, for months I was on the Nile, mostly alone, 9 months of paddling 4,000 miles, and to have that experience where you're sometimes 200 miles from anything, you know, except little humble villages, and to be totally integrated with the wildlife and the gorgeous birds flying over, migrating from Africa to Europe. And you go quietly along, and when you get back to civilization, Pete speaks so loudly, you know, and there's such, you know, activity and, you know, restlessness. And then to go to a village where they they savor life and experience at a time. They have a love and closeness with everyone in the village. And it's something we are losing very rapidly in the modern world. So I was very grateful for that. And looking out in the backyard and seeing a couple little cottontail rabbits munching away, and maybe 10 different species of birds just feeding and taking their bath, the three bird baths we have. And that just makes life much more enriched. Thank you.
Thank you, Grandpa.
Okay, here is the tribute to John Goddard. This is Thursday nights, and the auditorium is just starting to fill up, so John's on the front row already, and this is what it looks like in this Adventures Club. John has cancer, and he's about 88 years old, and it's amazing that he even made it here tonight. His wife and children are here as well. And the whole tribute is just for John Goddard. It will be starting in just a few minutes.
South. Kentucky. Well, I know it's awfully late, but I have to have the opportunity. This is not just a John Goddard day, but the friends of John Goddard. And my gratitude to you all. You know, I looked around a while back, and every face I saw was a trusted friend of years, you know, decades back. Then, who could support me in every area of exploration, adventure, and, you know, make me feel so humble that I'm still alive. But the last year has been very difficult. I was thinking tonight, how easy it is, or it was, to say, that's it. It's so easy to let go. I'm in a lost in a Canadian wilderness.
I see a wonderful little cozy nook. Baby, I just need to take 10 minutes there just to catch my breath. And I thought, oh, you can't do that. You know what happens when you stop at that temperature. So I'd be forced on. And I had a request in that experience. Carol came in and looked to me, took me by the levels, bills, labels, and say, I want you to make me a promise here and now. Don't you? Leave me alone. You promise. She said, our love between the two of us can bring us through. And several times there was an instance where I felt would be so such a relief, such easy release of everything. I mean, I think about my wonderful friends, and above all, the wife I've had, who's indescribable. We've been married 32 years now, and she's the main reason I'm still alive. She said, I want to hear you make that promise, John. You still have a lot to live for. And I said, all right, I promise. I know you well enough that if you let go, that's it. The finish. You're too young. I have a wife who's the most incredible combination of diplomacy and patience. Amazing insight and sensitivity, and every day that goes by, I have two blessings. I thank God that I'm still alive, and I thank God for so wonderful to have a confidant. Someone who brings a whole new understanding of love. Years ago, it's really reliable. kind of support and love and cooperation and help. Thank you all. Bless you every day for your existence in my life. I count your many blessings. We have a lot more than we realize. Thank you.